Hi, folks. We will be starting momentarily. Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Jenny Lyons, and I'm the Director of NOAA Ocean Service Public Affairs. I want to start by thanking you for joining us for this press conference today. We're here to announce long-term sea level rise projections with some significant impacts by mid-century. This press conference is being recorded. If you do not wish to be recorded, please disconnect at this time. We will begin with remarks from our speakers and then take questions from reporters. If you would like to ask a question, Click the hand icon in the GoToWebinar window next to your name. NOAA staff will call on each reporter who has virtually raised their hand, and your line will be unmuted. You can also use the questions tool in your GoToWebinar window to type a question for our speakers. Please be sure to state or type your full name and media affiliation when asking your question. With that, I have the honor of welcoming NOAA Administrator Dr. Rick Spinrad to open our call.
Thank you, Jenny. It really is my pleasure to join this event and to welcome everyone. Good afternoon to all of you. Before we dive into what this new report has to tell us about sea level rise, I just want to take a few minutes and acknowledge the guests who are joining us on the call today. We have NASA Administrator Senator Bill Nelson here. NASA, of course, plays an important partnering role in climate and sea level observations, particularly from space. We also have Nicole LaBeouf, the director of NOAA's National Ocean Service, who will provide an overview of what these projections mean and how communities can use them to plan ahead. Two expert scientists are also joining us today for the question and answer session. We've got William Sweet from NOAA's National Ocean Service and Ben Hamilton from NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory. Both are authors of this report and can provide insights into the data. Thank you all for being here today and for helping us understand the significance of planning for sea level rise. It's a critical piece of our national effort at NOAA to address climate change and to build a climate-ready nation. To set the stage, NOAA and our predecessor organizations have measured and forecasted sea levels for two centuries. What we're reporting on today is historic. The report NOAA just released with half a dozen federal partners provides the most up-to-date long-term sea level rise projections for all of the United States and territories. Using cutting-edge Earth observation technology, this report shows what we can expect in terms of sea level rise, both in our own lifetime and in future generations. It delivers projections by decade for the next 100 years and beyond. The projections are based on tide gauge and satellite observations and all the model ensembles from the sixth assessment report of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the IPCC. One of the most profound statements in this report is that the United States is expected to experience as much sea level rise in 30 years as we saw over the span of the entire last century. The report predicts sea levels along the US coast will rise 10 to 12 inches on average by the year 2050, with amounts varying regionally, primarily due to land shifts. Current and future emissions matter, but this will happen no matter what we do about emissions. If emissions continue at their current pace, it's likely that we will see at least 2 feet of sea level rise by the end of this century along the US coastline, again, higher or lower in some regions due to land shifts. And that estimate is on the conservative side. Failing to curb future emissions could cause even greater impacts to Americans. This report is a wake-up call for the United States, but it's a wake-up call that comes with a silver lining. It provides us with information needed to act now to best position ourselves for the future. It's going to take all of us, government, businesses, academia, communities, citizens, to make a difference in the future. As NOAA works to build a climate-ready nation, this data can inform coastal communities and businesses about current and future vulnerabilities in the face of climate change. This information can help those communities make smart decisions to keep people and property safe over the long run. I'll now turn it over to our next speaker, my colleague, NASA Administrator Bill Nelson, who will share how NASA contributes to providing the Earth observations needed to better understand our climate. Administrator Nelson.
Administrator Nelson, you may still be on mute. you can just click that microphone icon. There we go. We see you. We cannot hear you. Thank you, folks, for your patience. We are just getting Administrator Nelson's sound working.
So, Sarah, 3, 2.
We can hear you. Please go ahead.
Go ahead. Hey, thank you, Rick. I'm really glad to be here with you today. And it's important to underscore that this report supports previous studies and confirms what we've known all along, and that sea levels are continuing to rise at a very alarming rate, and it's endangering communities around the world. The sea level rise along US coastline, it's going to rise 10 to 12 inches on average, and that's by 2050. And if you look back, look how much sea level has already risen. I had a Senate Commerce Committee meeting down in Miami Beach about 10 years ago, and the estimate was from the experts that it had already risen over the last 40 years from that point, 5 to 8 inches. So that you can see that in the next 30 years, we could equal the total rise that we've seen over the past 100 years. And it's going to pose a major challenge in coastal cities. And of course, it's not just the Atlantic or the Gulf, it's also the Pacific as well. And the science is very clear, and that means it's past time to take action to address this climate crisis. So last month, NASA and NOAA announced that 2021 was tied for the 6th warmest year. This report highlights the challenges posed by a warming planet. Climate change is causing sea levels to rise, ocean surface temperatures to warm, and moisture to build in the atmosphere. And all of these facts are leading to more intense and destructive storms. And just think back to 3 years ago, the hurricane that came up off the west coast of Cuba between there and the Yucatan Peninsula. It was only a Category 1. It became a Category 2. It's going north in the Gulf. This is in August. And all of a sudden, that hot water in the Gulf, by the time over the last 2 days, it accelerated from a Category 3 to a Category 5 when it hit dead on at Tyndall Air Force Base in the Panhandle of Florida. The science of the last 20 years have settled the question of human behavior that is driving this climate change. And our next science ought to be focused on adaptation, mitigation, and responding to that climate change. And certainly we want to mitigate it as well. And we want to stop it as much as we can. But we're going to have a greater understanding and we're going to have more precision. For example, over the next decade, NASA is going to put up 5 great observatories. It's going to give us precision in our understanding of what's happening to the atmosphere. to the ice, to the land masses, and to the waters. We're going to put up later this year a mission called SWAT, and it's going to, for the first time, give us the elevation of our lakes, rivers, and streams, in addition to what we know on the elevation of the seas. This administration, the Biden-Harris administration's response to climate change, it matches this threat. It's a whole of government, all hands on deck to meet this moment. And an example of what this report provides is to tell us that this is exactly what's happening. Different agencies finally are coming together to leverage their expertise to advance our understanding and planning for the future. Rick, the partnership that we have with NOAA and EPA as well, this is all a part of bringing in a whole of government, bringing in all the other agencies of government. And in our agency, NASA, we are leveraging 60 years of space system development expertise, bringing this satellite technology down and putting it into a form that people can understand. Our sea level researchers have years of experience studying how Earth's changing climate will affect the ocean. NASA's work includes research forecasting on how much coastal flooding is happening. And we've got experience there in the last 10 years. And also, as I mentioned, developing a sea level rise projection tool to help communities plan for the future. And we're launching satellites to contribute data to a decades-long record of global sea surface height. And now for the first time with this SWAT, we're going to be able to know that rise in the lakes and streams and rivers. NASA is committed to protecting our home planet by expanding our monitoring capabilities and are continuing to ensure our climate data is not only accessible, but also understandable. And that's because this planet is our home, and it's the only one that we have. So I'm glad that NASA could lend our expertise to this report, helping the decision makers at every level, every scale, every agency, every level of government, and indeed the public, helping them make the decisions to do something about this climate change. Thanks, Rick, for letting me join in today.
Bill, thank you. It's such a pleasure to have NASA on as a partner on this important effort, and I think the collaboration between our teams has been extraordinary. There are, of course, many thanks across the board to our NOAA and NASA contributors, as well as many other agencies that are part of this report, and several academic institutes also contributed. It's not an overstatement to say that bringing the best-in-class information and data across government to help American communities and businesses and families, especially in a highly equitable fashion, understand the risks that they face from sea level rise, really is, as Bill said, an all-hands-on-deck endeavor. And with that, I'm delighted to welcome our next speaker, the director of NOAA's National Ocean Service, Nicole LaBeouf. Nicole, the floor is yours.
Thank you, sir. And thank you all for taking the time to hear about this important issue. The report we share with you today bears on our nation's economic health and prosperity and the well-being of all Americans. The information in this report is made possible by NOAA tide gauges, our coastal sentinels tracking conditions along all coastal and Great Lakes states, making up the National Water Level Observation Network. Some of our gauges have been recording water level data for more than 100 years. This network has long provided information vital for safe shipping and for predicting dangerous storm surge. More recently, NOAA's water level network allows us to monitor the steady creep of sea level rise and a rapid uptick in high tide flooding. It is from these measurements that we are able to understand what's happening year to year, and they allow us to look ahead and project what's coming. In addition to what we heard from NOAA Administrator Dr. Rick Spinrad, the technical report released today finds that sea level rise expected by 2050 will create a profound increase in the frequency of coastal flooding, even in the absence of storms or heavy rainfall. As some of you may recall, last July, we gathered for NOAA's annual announcement that looks back at high tide flooding that we experienced over the past year and looks ahead to what is expected in the coming year. During that announcement, I reported that some places experienced record-breaking coastal flooding for the year 2020. And I said the same thing the year before about 2019. I also explained that minor high tide flooding, sometimes called nuisance or sunny day flooding, happens when tides reach anywhere from 1.75 to 2 feet above the daily average high tide. High tide flooding causes water to spill onto streets and bubble up from storm drains that aren't built to handle that much water. So far, in most places, this type of flooding has been mostly disruptive, more like an annoyance or an inconvenience. However, as sea level rise continues, more damaging and destructive flooding that today typically occurs only during a big storm will happen more regularly without severe weather, such as during a full moon or with a change in winds or currents. Today's report finds that by 2050, moderate flooding, flooding that typically damages property and commerce, is expected to occur 10 times as often as it does today. What that means is that communities now dealing with nuisance flooding will be facing more damaging floods in just 30 years' time. Another way to think about this is that a single flooding event, one that now happens every 4 to 5 years on average in coastal communities in the Southeast United States, will occur 4 to 5 times per year. I was born and raised on the Texas Gulf Coast. I know the coastline is always changing. That's just what it does. But I can tell you with complete confidence that these are not the kinds of changes that we grew up with. Make no mistake, sea level rise is upon us. This report highlights that NOAA's ability to issue increasingly precise projections of sea level change is more critical than ever as sea levels and flood rates reach unprecedented levels in recorded history. NOAA's delivery of this information today makes it possible for businesses and communities to make informed decisions now, while there are still more options available to us and before it's too late to protect ourselves from the worst of these impacts. These data can help communities plan where to put their buildings, roadways, and essential infrastructure like hospitals and schools, and they can enable us all to work together to keep people safe and our nation prosperous in the face of rapid and profound change. With that, thank you again for your time, and thank you for joining us today. Back to you, Dr. Spinrad.
Thanks, Nicole, and thank you again to NASA Administrator Bill Nelson for speaking with us today. As you can see from the intros that we've made, this report, although offering sobering projections, can help inform coastal communities and businesses about current and future vulnerabilities in the face of climate change. Building on the foundation for the Climate Ready Nation concept that I described earlier, this information can help those communities make smart decisions and can keep people and property safe over the long run. So now we have an opportunity to go into the Q&A session. I'm going to throw it back over to Jenny Lyons, who will review the run of show, if you will, and how we're going to handle the questions and answers. Jenny?
Thank you all very much. We will now take questions about today's news from the media. We have two esteemed subject matter experts to help answer those questions: William Sweet with NOAA's National Ocean Service and Ben Hamlington with with NASA's Jet Propulsion Lab. Just to remind everyone, if you would like to ask a question, please click the hand icon in the GoToWebinar window next to your name in the attendees list that appears to the right of your screen. NOAA Communications will call upon each reporter who has a virtually raised hand. Once you're called on, your line will be unmuted. You may have to unmute on your side as well. You may also use the questions tool in your GoToWebinar window to type a question for our speakers about today's report. Please be sure to state or type your full name and media affiliation when asking your question. Just a moment, please, while we queue up our first question.
Thanks, Jenny. Our first question comes from David Abel from the Boston Globe. It's a written question, so I'm going to read it out. Can you please tell us how the estimate of 1 foot of sea level rise by 2050 differs from previous reports? Also, does the report have projections for beyond 2050? Do these projections take into account worst case scenario events such as the breakup of the Thwaites Glacier? Thank you.
So this is Rick Spinrad. I'm going to suggest, William, you take a first shot at that. If Ben wants to contribute as well, we can go to Ben.
Sure. Hi. Thanks for that question. We arrived at 1 foot or nearly 1 foot on average along the United States coastline by using a combination of the models, which are now really providing more confidence in their ability to predict 2050. Put another way is they, from high to low, they're all narrowed in to a more of a collapsed view of what's going to occur, combined with using the tide gauge and altimeter observations regionally, are all pointing to the same direction, more sea level rise along the United States coastline. This agreement is giving us confidence. It's putting in our headlights as to what's most likely to occur by 2050. Beyond that, we are looking to bound sort of the plausible range beyond 2150 into 2100 and beyond, because those types of unlikely but possible outcomes are important, and the known unknowns factor in. And so we provide this so folks won't be, well, let's just say they'll be prepared for a full range of possibilities. Ben, would you like to comment further?
Yeah, just to add on top of that, I think to answer the question kind of directly, that the possible contribution of rapid ice sheet loss, including that associated with, say, a collapse of Thwaites, that is accounted for within our scenarios. We have something we refer to as kind of rapid ice sheet loss within the report that we do factor in. Those higher scenarios definitely capture that possibility. I think it's important to note that when we talk about rapid, I mean, that doesn't mean on the order of a few years. That means on the order of several decades into the future. So we do have kind of a narrower range with the model scenarios out to 2050. And beyond that, we do our best to kind of capture the different possible storylines and how the Earth system will respond to ongoing climate. So yes, we do provide information after 2050. And yes, we do consider the possibility of that rapid ice sheet loss within our scenarios.
Thank you. Moving on to the next question, we're going to take a verbal question. I'm going to unmute the microphone for Seth Borenstein from the Associated Press. Seth, go ahead. Seth, you might still need to unmute yourself.
How's that? Can you hear me now?
Sure can.
Okay, thank you for doing this. In terms of a sense or proportion of the potential for damage, in the past, as you mentioned, this has been mostly nuisance flooding. Can you give us a sense of how many millions, hundreds of millions, or even billions of dollars we are looking at annually from just the high tide flooding? And then you add in the sea level rise to storm damage, you know, from the hurricanes and even winter storms we get. How big a damages are we expecting each year in mid-century range from this? Hundreds of millions, billions, tens of millions, millions. What are we looking at to give a sense of proportion here?
Thank you. I'm going to suggest, William, if you want to take a shot at that. I think we might also have Nicole still on the line. If you'd like to add a broader perspective, since Nicole, you had brought up some of the nuisance flooding issues in your comments. William?
Yeah, thanks for that question. You know, in the report, we definitely are predicting a flood regime shift. And what we mean by that is the minor nuisance-like flooding that's becoming a growing problem in many East and Gulf Coast communities, some West Coast, is likely to become damaging flooding. That extra foot on average or so around the country is just going to reach further inland and grow deeper and more severe. It's hard to put an actual cost on this. We are talking about flooding reaching about 3 feet or so above the average high tide. And there's mapping capabilities that NOAA and others where you can actually look and zoom in and see what's in harm's way. But one thing is for certain, when that type of flooding is predicted to occur now, the National Weather Service, in partnership with local emergency managers, issue a coastal flood warning for serious risk to property and life. And so it's very disruptive, and it's very, it's something that right now causes a lot of, let's say, a response is definitely something that's immediate and it's necessary. Moving forward without action, if that becomes routine, we're talking about 3, 4, 5 events per year on average, there are going to be serious consequences unless action are taken. To the extent that we can put a financial dollar bill on that amount is something I can't answer right now.
So just to, I can add one thing there. I mean, Seth, I think an important thing here is that this report sits at the foundation of the type of assessments you're looking at. So this updated, these updated scenarios, projections, the assessment, the high tide flood assessments, I think that's it's really a next step and a step beyond what was in this report. We're really trying to provide that authoritative information that you can base these types of assessment upon.
But I guess what I'm asking is how many, I mean, if you just look at New York City and Sandy, which was a storm, obviously, but you have an awful lot of infrastructure right on the coast there. And then you look, you know, you just keep going down coast, Baltimore, Washington. So maybe just a sense of how much vulnerable property is out there. I mean, I guess, you know, for people, especially in the Midwest, they're going to go, so what? How about a sense of proportion here to tell readers, so what?
Yeah, I'm happy to take a stab at that. I am not an economist, but I do agree with Ben and Billy that these data provide a baseline opportunity for all manner of our private industry, reinsurance, insurance, real estate, to begin to take a more granular look at this. What I will say is that the magnitude of these impacts, direct and cascading, will be high. 40% of the U.S. population lives within 60 miles of our coastlines. There will be highly variable impacts along those coastlines, but there's no denying that a large portion of our economy and revenue and tax base are right there front and center. In addition to that, I would say to our folks that live away from the coastlines that almost everything that we use, eat, and wear comes through the base of our supply chain, which are our ports along our coasts. So we can only begin to assess with these data how we need to shore up our coastal infrastructure from our ports to our military installations. And this is why we really emphasize an all-of-government approach in development of these data so that we can inform across the federal space. But it will be these kind of data that allow the private sector to begin to take these risks into account and quantify at a regional scale the kinds of impacts that you were asking about.
Thank you, Nicole. We'll move on to the next question, which is a written question. Steve Herman from Voice of America asks, what are the most important mitigation projects that could be undertaken by the federal government and communities to address sea level rise?
Again, I'll throw it over to both William and Ben if you want to take a shot at that.
Sure. Well, I think it's very important to understand as sea level rise continues, that storm surge flooding is replaced by tidal flooding. You know, we're not holding back the tides, and eventually it becomes an elevation issue. lower elevation lands are just at more risk of flooding than higher. And what we've done in this report is help not only determine how sea level is going to rise around the country, it's not going to rise like it is in a bathtub, but also to determine what are the tides and storms effects going to be on the landscape, and keeping it real, using ground truth thresholds that mean things on a day-to-day basis in people's lives. So if we can put it in that context, we can then have folks understand what it is they need to do to mitigate against that. Stormwater systems need to be examined because the downhill gradient in many of these coastal areas is no longer there as water starts to come up through the stormwater systems and spill into the streets. When there's an opportunity to relocate major infrastructure, schools, fire departments, energy plants, elevation needs to be considered. And so I think with these types of projections and the types of maps and information and science coming out of our agencies of NOAA and NASA and USGS and others, that they use this to use and plan for the future with higher sea levels. Ben, something you'd like to add?
Yeah, I mean, certainly specific mitigation strategies are kind of outside my area of expertise, but I will say within this report, we had this very specific focus on this near-term time period. So from now out to 2050, and it's really with the view that this is an immediate problem. These efforts are gonna be underway to mitigate some of these effects, and we need to provide the information to support those strategies and steps that are being taken. So I do think that the way this report is structured and organized, we are trying to provide the information that's needed there. And William kind of touched on this too. I think the observations that you heard about in some of the earlier presentations really key to supporting the mitigation adaptation strategies that get put into place. So I think it's kind of an across the board support of these efforts, and hopefully this report is very useful in doing so.
Thank you. We'll move on to our next question, which is coming from Zach Coleman at Politico. Zach, I'm going to unmute you, and you might need to unmute yourself as well. Go ahead, Zach. Going to give Zach just a second to unmute himself. Okay, Zach, I'm going to circle back around in a few minutes. Thanks. Let me take a check. We have another question verbally from Alex Harris with the Miami Herald. Alex, I'm going to unmute you. And you might need to unmute yourself as well. Go ahead.
Hey there. So I have a question, I think it's for Billy, about how these sea rise projections differ geographically. You say a foot on average. Where will we see more? Will we see the least around the country?
The average number for 2050 of 10 to 12 inches will largely be exceeded or reached or exceeded along most of the East and Gulf Coast communities. For a couple reasons, primarily land subsidence, land sinking in many of these geographic reasons for both natural and non-natural reasons. Natural being compaction of sediments, as is an issue in much of the Mississippi area. Unnatural would be withdrawal of freshwater and subsurface fossil fuels for consumption, which is an issue along much of the Gulf as well as the Mid-Atlantic. And so those factors will contribute to a higher than average sea level rise. When you couple that with flooding, the high tide flooding as mentioned, it sort of follows suit. There's just more variability. When the winds blow, we go out sailing, but it really sets up water along the East Coast or Gulf Coast where you have a wide shallow continental shelf compared to the West Coast. So it's a combination of those reasons where higher than average sea level rise and a very energetic ocean that will allow more flooding to occur, higher than average amounts over most of the East and Gulf Coast compared to the West Coast and our island states and territories.
I can also add just real quick on that. We from the analysis done in the report and some of the figures that you'll see there, there is this East Coast, West Coast separation where we have higher rates on the higher projections on the East Coast versus the West Coast. So William already touched on an important factor there. Certainly subsidence is contributing to that, but also changes in ocean dynamics associated with changes in the Gulf Stream, for instance, that's also driving slightly higher projections along the East Coast than compared to the West Coast. So we do see a little bit of this East Coast, West Coast separation. I think for the West Coast, it's important to note that we're not going to see below, significantly below the global average. For instance, I live here on the West Coast. With some of our observational records, we've seen a little bit less sea level rise than we have in other parts of the U.S. coastlines. But the expectation is that sea level rise in the West Coast will also kind of track and keep up with the global average. So we do a lot in this report trying to explain those regional differences. And we do have this process-based understanding of where those differences come from, and then those go into our projections.
Thank you, William and Ben. I'm going to do a question in writing from Ezra Romero from KQED, the NPR station for the San Francisco Bay Area. He asks, with the change from the 2017 numbers, how do you advise regions like the San Francisco Bay Area with millions of residents to alter their plans that are currently based on the 2017 numbers? And as a follow-up, yes, and how do you think it might change states like California's sea level rise plans that are currently ongoing? And as a follow-up, I've had a few reporters in the question bar ask if you could just be sure to touch on one of the original questions that was asked about how the 2050 projections differ than past estimates in the 2017 report. Thank you.
So I'm going to say you guys are doing such a good job complementing each other in your answers. Let's go ahead and start with Ben and then throw it over to William. Go ahead, Ben.
Yep. So I'm going to maybe give a slightly more technical answer on why we see a difference in 2050. So one of the reasons we see, and I guess to reiterate what we see a narrower range between the scenarios in 2050 than in the previous report. And this is really just driven by an improved understanding of what's going to happen with the ice sheets, right? So the ice sheet models have advanced, scientific knowledge has advanced on some of these processes that can contribute to sea level rise. And that gets built in directly into our scenarios, and the trajectory has essentially changed from what was in the 2050 report. So it really does reflect the latest and greatest science. A lot of that was assessed within the IPCC AR6. So when you factor that in, you do get this narrower range. In 2050, we add in the observation agreement, and I think we can provide a little more certainty on what's going to happen out to 2050. In terms of the question about California specifically, obviously, again, I live here in California and well aware of kind of the planning activity, but plans that have been made and the numbers that are being used. I think it's important to that kind of we continue to support the information, convey that this is the latest science. We're trying to capture that within our scenarios. And this scenario framing, which I'll let William speak to in just a second, it really does allow us to provide a plausible range that doesn't have dramatic shifts from one report to the other. So I think that trying to frame these scenarios, how they've changed according to the science, and then communicate that out, I think that's going to be critical here in California as well as it is in other places. But William, feel free to jump in.
Thanks, Ben. Right. You know, one of the goals of the task force in general is to sort of bound the plausible rise amounts that could happen. We start with the global and then we downscale that. As our science improves based on better modeling, better understanding of our ice sheets, more observations, one of our goals is to whittle down the plausible range by 2100 while still considering sort of the known unknowns that really could contribute sort of wild cards to higher amounts of sea level rise than might be, you know, the more likely scenarios. So 2050 is in our headlights, and we can speak with sort of confidence and clarity as to what we expect to occur. 2100 and beyond, we are going to continue as the science advances to provide the best actual information so communities can plan. You know, California is not alone in you know, folks planning ahead. The Army Corps of Engineers has done a remarkable job for decades at incorporating sea level rise into their planning. And it's oftentimes, you know, risk-based in terms of how you anticipate that asset or system of systems functioning under higher sea level and doing those stress tests. So, you know, adaptive management is oftentimes the path that folks take in decision making, because the uncertain, the future is inherently uncertain. But the goal of our interagency task force is to provide as much certainty or at least clarity as to what could occur and bound the problem so folks can respond and plan accordingly.
Thank you. Our next question is a verbal question from Evan Bush at NBC. Evan, I'm unmuting your line now. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, thanks for doing this. My question is just about emission scenarios. What assumptions underlie the 2050 10 to 12 inches measurements? I mean, is that a high emission scenario? I guess help me understand that. And then the second question is just, can you apply this to understanding domestic climate migration at all? I mean, how many people might have to move by 2050 as a result of these numbers? Thank you.
Ben, let's go to you first on the scenarios piece, and then William can jump in.
Yeah, it's a good question about kind of the storylines attached to our different scenarios. So we have the low to high scenario, which are defined by those 2100 global mean sea level target dates. So the key thing in 2050 is that those scenarios, there's not a great deal of divergence. So I already talked about kind of the narrower range from low to high in 2050. So we have a little more confidence regardless of emissions scenario out to 2050 of kind of what window we're going to fit through with sea level rise. That all changes as you get out to 2100 and beyond, right? So a simple way of saying this, that the higher your emissions, the higher your warming is, the higher our scenario that you're going to have to choose or the pathway that you'll be on. So it's important to kind of, and we do this in the report, right? We separate out these two time periods a little bit. We have this 2050 time period where there's not a lot of divergence within the scenarios, not a lot of emissions dependence, maybe another way of saying it. And then beyond that, they start to become much more dependent on emissions pathways and future emissions. And I think the other piece to consider here is that there are these, and I already mentioned this with Thwaites, there are these rapid ice sheet loss scenarios that could contribute to sea level. Those also help drive towards those higher scenarios, like the intermediate high and high scenario going into the future. So those scenarios are really driven by high emissions, high warming, plus the potential possibility of these rapid ice sheet loss as well. So we do try to provide storylines attached to each of these. Those storylines are a little bit different in 2050 than beyond. And again, we try to convey that with the structure of the report and also our explanations of it. But William, I'll kick it to you and also to answer that question on migration.
Thanks. I don't think we're talking about migrating at 2050. You know, the amount of rise that we're seeing is, you know, considered more likely or expected in the next 30 years is the amount is we can adapt to. I think it's important to understand what our vulnerabilities are at the coast right now. You know, one of the goals of this task force in this report as to help sort of further graduate risk within the floodplain defined by FEMA. We know flood risk is not the same, and we know that it is changing due to sea level rise. And if we can match that to ground truth impacts that make sense to people, they can understand sort of what have the consequences been to these types of flooding? What can we do to mitigate and prepare for more of this type of flooding? Whether it is, you know, green infrastructure, to help, you know, provide protection where we recognize there are vulnerabilities, whether it's upgrading storm and wastewater systems to deal with higher sea levels. It's, you know, providing the maps and the tools so folks can understand where things are currently situated and how best to reconcile with the future projections. We will find a way to adapt and mitigate as we move forward. But the first part is really understanding and becoming aware of what we're actually going to be dealing with. know, with the maps and the data that these groups, these interagency sets of folks are putting out, is to do just that. So no one is taken by surprise, and the planning process can begin now to mitigate against the impacts that are coming down the road.
Thanks, William. Our next question is a written question from Dina Pulver with USA Today. She asks, which parts of the country do you expect to see the biggest increases from sea level rise, which I believe you spoke to previously. But she also asks, what impact is sea level rise going to have on storm surge events? Thank you.
William, you want to take a shot first, and then Ben?
Sure. You know, right now we definitely have a hot spot of sea level rise in the sort of the central Gulf. You know, areas of Louisiana, land is disappearing in front of people's eyes over decades. Within generations, there are stories of land loss. That's being projected forward into the future. And a lot of that's due to that land subsidence. That's largely a natural response to the compaction of sediments. You know, there are some higher rates of sea level rise in areas of Texas coastline and all the way to Louisiana, as well as the mid-Atlantic as well. Some of that is due to adjustments due to the last ice age, you know, 10,000 years ago or so, as well as extraction of drinking water and fossil fuel, things that can be changed, right? If you end the disturbance, you can maybe mitigate against some future sea level rise. You know, the impacts of that are, you know, largely following suit. Where we have higher sea level rise, you have more chance for increasing flood risk. And that we're trying to graduate and granulate around the coast as well, so folks get a sense of what does a change in mean sea level actually mean to our community, so decisions can be made now to prepare for the future. Ben, anything to add?
Yeah, not too much to add. I think William covered it in terms of the regional differences. I think just to add one item there, I mean, with the West Coast, we certainly do see lower amounts of projected sea level rise, but those are not relative to the global average, right? So I think just kind of framing all these together is important as well.
Before we, as we queue up the next question, I just wanna pop in to note, we have about 10 more minutes for this press call, so time for a couple of more questions. Thanks.
Thanks, Jenny. I'm going to open it up verbally to Joe Bartostik from KTUU in Alaska, and then Zach Coleman with Politico. I promise we're going to you next. Zach, you are unmuted. You might need to unmute yourself.
Can you hear me?
Oh, I'm sorry, Joe. Yes, go ahead.
All right. Sorry about that earlier. So yeah, I just wanted to get a sense, you might have touched on this a little bit, but I mean, is there a sense that in any regions that we've exceeded our ability to adapt to this type of sea level rise? And, you know, I mean, what message is there for less well-off communities? I mean, we're talking about engineering our way out of some of this. I mean, not every community can easily afford to do that. So what's the message there?
Before I throw it over to, and I'm going to suggest William, then Ben, this is Rick Spinnard again, and I do want to point out, I was looking for a place to make this comment, this question seems appropriate, and that is that we look at this particular study and the summarized findings in a broad context. And so, as many of you know, we're looking right now at how at NOAA we're going to end up spending close to $3 billion under the bipartisan infrastructure law, some of which is tied to mitigating and dealing with floods. And so I think part of your question does broaden the scope of what we're trying to do at NOAA with respect to our operational responsibilities. So I throw it over to William, but I'd ask the reporters to recognize that this is all part of a much, much broader Earth system context within NOAA's mission, certainly. William?
Yeah, thank you. Well, you know, those are important questions, right? Being able to respond oftentimes depends on the capacity of the area to respond, the population and demographics and so often. But what is required is information about the changing environment, as well as information about the current snapshot of how, you know, what is the landforms, what is the maps, the topography, the bathymetry. And we're committed, all agencies, at providing free and available data that, based upon the best science and the best data. So all communities, big and small, rural, urban, have this information and then can help, you know, determine what's best for them, what they're able to do, what the options are. And obviously this is still a national conversation. We do know that, you know, many solutions are typically now found and funded locally. And, you know, that's sort of how things are going right now, but as impacts become more widespread, I suspect it's going to be still in our national conversation and dialogue of how to best to adapt at this holistically across the country.
Yeah, I can just add quickly. I think Billy nailed that. I think that the key thing for me is that we're really providing this information across the entirety of the U.S. coastlines for the Caribbean, Hawaiian Islands, or that Pacific Islands, and also for Alaska. So this is good information that can be used for planning. So I think that's a big part of what we're doing here.
Yeah, and I'd like to just add to those comments that we do recognize that there are communities around our coastlines that are more vulnerable to these kinds of impacts because of their history and being underserved to begin with. So having this information available to everyone, community planners, decision makers at all levels of government, is really the first step. It's also enabling the communities themselves to see the impacts on a map where they live, and helps them to have a voice in this process. But we are focused on making sure that this information is widely available and translatable to the public for that very reason. It helps just to get us as much as possible on a level playing field. But we will absolutely be looking at end user needs, particularly in vulnerable communities.
Thank you, Nicole. We just heard from Zach with Politico. I'm going to try to open the line for Joe with KTUU. Joe, you're unmuted. You might need to unmute yourself as well if you'd like to ask your question verbally. Otherwise, I will go ahead and read it. Okay. I'm going to go ahead and read it. Joe with KTUU asks, he's asking about Alaska and asks what areas are likely to see the most impact. There are already native villages that are having to relocate and rebuild as a result of sea level rise. He also mentions that Southeast Alaska uses a lot of ferries for transportation, so there's infrastructure already built for the current system. What is being done to prepare and help mitigate dealing with infrastructure during when sea level rise is a factor?
William, then Ben.
I'll take a quick answer and hand it to Ben. Well, you know, Southeast Alaska is fairly unique in our country, not the world, where sea levels are actually dropping fairly rapidly, and that's because of the relative contribution of land rebounding out of the ocean, out of the water. Whether or not that rate of land rising will continue to outpace the amount of ocean rising, we will see, but we project that so folks can get a sense of, you know, how long might that persist. It poses a different challenge for maritime transportation and commerce. You know, the water starts the what you thought was coastside all of a sudden is not so coastside, challenging with piers and docks and so forth. Northern Alaska is different. The response there is one of sinking or of land rising, of having an apparent sea level rise, and that's projected to continue, coupled with the fact that we're losing sea ice in these areas and ocean roughness and storms and wave and erosion. You know, that's a series of compounding problems that we hope to tackle next round in this task force, really bringing in sort of the waves and erosion and landform changes to better kind of address those projected changes. But, you know, Alaska is obviously observation sparse, you know, giant lands, a lot of coastline, but, you know, really leaning on our satellites and working with our counterparts at NASA to really get a you know, a mile high view as to what's going on to really provide information, which in this case, land sinking versus land rising within a state poses a series of challenges that we hope to at least provide information so that they can address and take appropriate response.
Yeah, and not much to add on my end, other than I think it's a really notable difference between the southern coast of Alaska and the northern parts of Alaska within the report. And William touched on an important thing. I think that in some of these areas, the satellite role, satellite observations will be playing an increasingly important role as we try to understand these processes and then factor them into to the projections that we're providing.
I think we have time for just one last quick question before we close the call. Thanks.
Thanks, Jenny. Our final question is from Sean Sublett with the Richmond Times-Dispatch. Go ahead, Sean, you're unmuted.
Thank you very much, appreciate that. Two quick questions as we close. One, could either one of you speak to how confident you are about these projections compared to paleoclimate reconstructions of sea level rise? In other words, how we know this is so much different than centuries ago? And two, is there anything additional we can say about inland bays, estuaries, tidal rivers, aside from the general 10 to 12 inch scenario? Thank you.
Ben, you wanna start on the confidence and then throw it over to William?
Yes. So the way I would say that these scenarios in this report really do capture the latest and greatest science. And it's very consistent with what was in the IPCC sixth assessment report. So the way this works is we model the individual processes that contribute to sea level, and then we put those together to generate these scenarios. So there's an incredible amount of effort and observations that goes into understanding the future projections for each individual scenario. Huge numbers of scientists who are working on each one of these individually. So our understanding of what's been happening over the past, say, century, and then what might happen in the future has really advanced dramatically. And we build all that in, put those pieces together, and build that into this report. So I would say that in terms of the near term, out to 2050, we have quite a bit of confidence. And then where the models show disagreement or uncertainty, we factor that in beyond 2050. So just to make it clear, I think we are trying to capture the full extent of our scientific understanding within these scenarios.
And in closing out that question, I think, you know, as we move inland up the estuaries, up these tidal creeks, you know, the tide's going to go where the tide wants to go. And this has implications for any tidally connected body of water. It should will experience sea level rise in the impacts associated with it. You know, this is an area where fresh meets the salt. So there's salt implications of saltwater intrusion, of aquifers and of farmland, of drinking water, and the fact that as we start to experience heavier rains from a warming climate, the two of them meet together, storm surges and rainfall meeting. It's a challenging place to get right for long-term predictions and short-term predictions. So it's something we are going to continue to work on, both weather scale forecasting and longer term probabilistic assessments, so folks can plan both for urban environments and the natural environments alike in terms of management.
Thank you all. With that, I just want to thank again today's speakers, NOAA Administrator Rick Spinrad, NASA Administrator Bill Nelson, NOAA National Ocean Service Director Nicola Buff, and our subject matter experts, William Sweet of NOAA, and Ben Hamilton of NASA for their time and participation. A recording of today's briefing will be online shortly in both our press release and media advisory, both available on NOAA.gov in the news section. And finally, if you have any follow-up questions, please contact me, Jenny Lyons at jennie.lyons@noaa.gov. Again, that's jennie.lyons@noaa.gov. This concludes today's video press conference. Thank you so much for joining us.